song that we're about to sing comes from the book of Psalms, and it just says, satisfy my soul with the best of heaven. Satisfy my soul with the fullness of your love. My soul faints after you, seeking your presence. My soul faints after you, seeking your power. My soul faints after you, seeking your glory.
Thank you. morning, Epic Church. I said, good morning, Epic Church. Are we excited to be in the house of the Lord this morning? Come on, let's stand up on our feet and give God his praise. We worship you, Lord. He's alive in us this morning. Come on, here we go.
I was lost with a broken heart. You picked me up and I'm set apart. From the ash I'm born again. Forever safe in the Savior's hands. You are more than my words could say. I follow you for all my days. I fix my eyes following your way. Forever free and unending grace. Cause you are, you are, you are my freedom. We live to higher, we live to higher.
Sing it again. We lift you higher. Sing it again. Come on.
You are, you are, you are my freedom. We lift you higher.
One more time.
We lift you higher. You are, you are, you are my freedom. We lift you higher.
Hey!
You are. We'll be right back.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Somebody give him praise.
Somebody praise him.
Hallelujah. Father, you're worthy.
Glory.
Come on, he's worthy this morning. Does anybody else believe that he's worthy this morning? He's worthy of all of our praise.
We love you, Jesus.
Is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name.
Sing it again, my home.
Blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. When darkness seems to hide His face, I rest on His unchanging grace. Every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. My anchor holds within the veil. Yeah, Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong. In the Savior's love, through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. When He shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in Him be found, dressed in His righteousness alone, faultless stand before the throne. Christ alone.
Come on, sing it with us.
Cornerstone, we pray strong in the same. Storms. Savior's love through the storm. He is Lord, Lord of all.
He is Lord of all this morning. Lord of everything. Father, we praise you. Father, we thank you for changing us, healing us. No matter where we've been, we're not going to go back to where we used to be. We're not going to go back to where we were before we knew you, God. Just lift your hands right now. Father, we worship you. Thank you for your grace. Thank you. A new one for you this morning. It's called I Won't Go Back. Sing it with us. Here we go.
I've been I won't let it pass. to be before your presence came and changed me.
Yeah, I won't go back.
I won't go back.
I can't go back
to the way you
Lord, before your presence
before
came.
Your presence came.
We have to remind ourselves. Hallelujah. You know, last week we talked about in the Word, sometimes you've got to find out what you're not. In fact, every time you find out what you're not, so you know who you are. Part of discovery of who you are in Christ and who He's called us to be, we find that out by finding out what we no longer are. So, I just want to sing this part again. I want you to make it as a declaration. I've been healed.
Free.
Oh, I love it.
Free.
I have.
Free.
I've been. How about you?
Delivered.
How about you? Who in this house? Wave at me and say, that's me.
I found joy.
How many of you found joy?
Peace.
Oh, peace.
I've been changed.
Yes. Thank you for His healing virtue.
Free.
I'm so glad I'm free.
Delivered.
I am delivered. This morning I'm delivered.
Joy.
Hallelujah.
Peace.
I have peace.
now is the moment. Today.
No reason to wait. This is it.
I've been changed.
I've been changed. This is it.
I've been changed.
Today, Lord, we stand before you as very grateful people. We enter your gates today with thanksgiving and into your courts with praise. We are thankful, O God, not only that you have saved us from an eternity separated from you, but Lord, you have saved us for this moment. And Lord, we are thankful that the keeping power and grace of your presence continues to help us when we face the impossible, when we think it's all over, when we don't know what to do next. We still can't go back. The one thing we know we can't do, we close the door on the past. I don't want to go back to old behaviors. I don't want to keep doing the same thing over and over and trying to find something different. Lord, I'm moving forward, and I will not let this moment pass me by. Hallelujah. There's an old song that I used to love. It was about, I don't remember all the words, but it was his holding on to his unchanging hand. When everything else changes, he doesn't. When nothing else makes sense, he's still there. Keep holding on to his unchanging hand. So, let the storms come, let the wind blow. Whatever it is, I'm holding on to the one immovable fact and truth of my life. Amen? He is our God, and we can trust him today with everything. Find somebody, say, I'm not going back. I'm not going to go back. I won't go back.
I won't go back. I can't go back to the way it used to be before your presence came and changed me. I won't go back. I can't go back to the way it used to be before your presence came.
Greetings and salutations, Epic family and guests, and thank you for joining us today. If you are a first-time guest, please fill out the connection card located in the seat pocket in front of you. For more information, visit our website at epiclakeland.com.
There are three ways to connect for prayer here at Epic Church. One, call your life group leader. Two, email us at info@epiclakeland.com. And three, fill out a connection card and place it in the offering basket.
Next Sunday at 9 a.m. is Dream Team 4.0. This is the final step to entering the ministry team here at Epic Church. Child care will be provided and registration begins at 8:45.
And now, back to the service.
Hallelujah. Listen, amen. We're so excited because today we're actually running full force over in the other sanctuary, the Legacy Theater. And we're excited. We're having, you know, when businesses open up, they do something called soft openings. Well, we're kind of having soft openings right now. So some of your people you may not see in here are over in that room already in that sanctuary, already starting to feel it out over there and get things set. And so we're excited about that. Amen. For those of you who have may not know what we're talking about, you may be here with us for the first time. As you can tell, it's getting pretty full in this room, and we're excited to be opening another sanctuary that will be running simultaneously at the same time. So what will happen is everything that's happening in here will be happening there on a big screen, great big screen. It's a beautiful theater. If you haven't had a chance to take a look at it, I just suggest you take a look before you leave today. Just walk over there and just take a look and walk around and see what it feels like. It's 100% up for everything that we needed to have happen, because last week the offering that we received was enough to finish phase two. Amen. Phase three.
All right.
Phase three is kind of, it is something that we need. It is two HD cameras. High definition cameras. We need those for our web presence, as well as for being able to have even a better image. But right now it's a good image, so don't think it's not great. It's a great image, but with high def, it will be a phenomenal image. And so I'm just letting you know, because we're kind of doing this in phases. We don't have to have those cameras to keep going. Understand what I'm saying? We just need them. Does that make sense? Because we don't stop. Once God says, we go for it. So that's where we are. We just letting you know. I'm just bringing you up to date and keeping you up to date. We're believing God. It's about $6,000 now for those two cameras, $3,000 each. And then we will have entered the high def age. And everything else, though, amen, all of the other upgrades have been done. Isn't that awesome? All we need is that, and we are golden there. Amen. So I want to thank you. God bless you. Doing it debt-free. We're believing God. And as we keep doing this together, you know, it doesn't all fall on one person. As we do this together, God makes a way. We are trusting God. We know that He has everything that we need, and it's already taken care of. He's already provided. Amen. We're going to receive our morning tithes and offerings. Hallelujah. Today, without much fanfare, if you'll just prepare yourselves, because we're going to receive. Come on, ushers, please. Here at Epic Church, just to remind us why we do what we do, we're very purposeful in the way we do things. We believe that God called us to live purposefully and intentionally, and so we do things that way. And we realized one day how important it was that we delineate the tithe from the offering. Because the tithe is something that we do as a result of our obedience to God, and it is out of gratitude, but the truth is we do it in obedience. It comes out of a heart of obedience. So we give we present our tithe to the Lord, because we believe that the tithe is holy and belongs to the Lord. So we don't really give it to Him, we just present it back to Him. Does that make sense? So we always receive our tithe first. And then after we receive our tithe, then we give our free will offering. The free will offering is the offering you give out of the abundance of your heart. It's just supposed to be hilarious. It's supposed to be joyful. It's supposed to be, you know, that's the way we give. So we give hilariously and joyfully in our offering, which is the second time you'll come to the basket. Just help everybody understand. Sometimes we do things and we don't always know why we do it. This morning, Pastor Stanley is out of town. Normally he is here receiving, so it was my privilege this morning to get to do this. I want to tell you one more time, thank you. Thank you for being a faithful people. Thank you for prospering, and in that prosperity, to be faithful to God, faithful to the house, to have hearts of generosity. You are awesome. Epic Church, you are an awesome church. Oh, yeah, changes everywhere. Pastor Steve said, there's just changes there. All kinds of things are happening as a result of your faithfulness. If you'll stand to your feet, please. I want you to get your tithe ready. Everyone standing, please. Hallelujah. You ready? And we're going to give this today in obedience and thanksgiving to the Lord that we had a job or we had income or whatever it was that allowed us to give Him 10%. Amen. Why don't you make
our
your way?
Father, who is in heaven, hallowed be your name. Our Father, who is in heaven, hallowed be your name. Our Father.
Confusing. Thank y'all for doing this. We do this because it is important. We felt God led us to do this. So everybody stand back up. We're going to come and receive our offering now. Some of you I saw were bringing. That's all right. Go ahead and those of you who did not, the opportunity is at hand now for you to hilariously, with joy, yay, come and bring your offering. Jesus, is this offering? I should say. When I got up this morning and I was praying, it was like I heard chains breaking in the atmosphere. And so the Lord told me, when you pray over the offering this morning, because I knew I was going to be up, He said, I want you to break the chains that have been placed, that some of us have been living. It's like it's been, it was like it. People were just wrapped around with chains when it came to jobs, inheritances, raises, anything that has to do with the prosperity in the financial realm. So this morning, if you want those chains to come off you, and off your situation, off your job, off your business, off of whatever it is, we're going to pray this morning as we pray over this offering and pray for those chains of limitation that have held you down and have been against you right now to be broken off of you now in Jesus' name. Amen. So, Father, today in Jesus' name, Pastor Steve and I come into agreement with your word. Lord, today we declare your word that nothing will be withheld from those who walk uprightly. And because of obedience, O God, and our joyful giving, you are opening the windows of heaven. And I break and bind every assignment of the enemy that has stolen and has caused people to stand in one place and not be able to progress and move forward. Right now, I hear the chain breaking in Jesus' name.
of no effect. Call them to leave in Jesus' name and release us for the full inheritance in the name of Jesus. Everyone who agreed said amen. 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 Hallelujah. Amen. I've been changed, healed. That preached the sermon, you know, didn't it? Thank you. Hallelujah. You know, when you don't know how to pray, you know what you need to do? It's easy. Just thank God. When you don't know how to pray, you don't know anything else to do, you just thank God. Hallelujah. I'll need my glasses. Arise, shine, for thy light is come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon you. How many of you ever heard that scripture before? Familiar scripture. I love that scripture, and it's out of the book of Isaiah. Isaiah chapter 60, and speaking of a time yet to come when Jesus would come to this earth and do what he has done for us, bear our sins, our sorrows, our burdens, our griefs, and that in that day we could arise and shine. Now, the word arise means to get up. Pretty clear what that means, get up. Except that in the Hebrew it means this, to shake yourself free of the of dust, which in their day, that meaning in the Hebrew was they applied ashes to their bodies when they were in grief. So shake yourself from this dust, this grieving dust, that and it says it's like a female mourning slave. So shake yourself free from the dust, the residue, and the grief of the bondage that has been in your life. Arise and shine. The word shine there, it means to be set on fire. Not quite like the light shining. It really means to be fiery, set on fire. So arise, shine. Here's the interesting thing about that. You do that for a reason, because your light has come. So what becomes clear in that passage of scripture is that we are being instructed that as we have come into the light, that we must arise. We've got to shake ourselves free. Arise, shine. We've got to be fiery, get set on fire, because our light has come. But not only that, and the glory of the Lord has risen upon you. So what is particularly clear is that when Jesus comes into our lives, there should be a remarkable and measurable difference. Amen? Religion tells you you do the least to get by. Relationship says you do the most to please him. That's the difference. The very first thing in Genesis chapter 1, first verse of Genesis chapter 1, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was on the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters. Then God said, "Let there be light." And there was light. And God saw the light and that it was good. And God divided the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. So the evening and morning were the first day. His very first creation was what? His very first creation was a division between the darkness, the confusion, and the word darkness means obscurity, from the obscurity. The very first thing he did was impact the atmosphere to such a degree that the light was separated from the darkness. Sometimes in our easy believism, in our desire to be socially kind of politically correct, we don't talk about light and darkness. The only thing that really makes light what it is the fact that it is the opposite of. If you don't understand darkness, then light means nothing to you. Amen. Understand this, that darkness can never overtake light. As long as there's light, there cannot be darkness. But light can overtake darkness. Darkness of its own properties cannot remain darkness as long as there is. Now, I have lights on me right now. They get brighter, and you can see they get brighter and dimmer. But however you look at this thing, light dispels darkness. The very first act that God did on this earth was to say, I need to make sure you understand that there is light and there is dark. Now, Jesus came, you know, and what did he say? He said, I am the light, I'm the true light. He said those things. But he didn't just say those things about himself. It's interesting when you read through the scriptures. I'm going to have several scriptures this morning if you want to jot them down. We'll be putting them up on the screen as well. But it's John chapter 1, verse 4 says this, that in him, talking about Jesus, was life. And the life was the light of men. And the light shines in the darkness. But look at this. And the darkness did not comprehend it. So here's part of the issue for us. In him is light. In him is life. When we come into relationship with Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, we have life. Our lives have now been joined together with him, and there is light. And when light, because he is the light, and his light becomes the light in us, it says that here's what's interesting about that is darkness will not understand it. You cannot reason out bondage. Shall I say that again? The darkness in our life will never leave because we are logical or we reason it out or we try to make friends with it. Darkness does not comprehend light. I'll say it again. Darkness does not comprehend light. So if you think you're going to catch holiness, the darkness in our lives will never understand. You just have to rule over it. You can't reason with it. You can't try to make your bondage feel better. You just have to rule over it. Y'all are being real quiet this morning. So when I know there is darkness in my life, I can either spend, let me put it this way, I can waste time playing around with the darkness and bondage of my life, trying to give it justice, justifying it. Spend time, you know, kind of, I'll leave you alone if you leave me alone. We can live like that, wasting our time trying to coexist with darkness. Or we can rule over it. The light separated from the darkness. Do you understand that? When God created the earth, he separated the light out. He didn't say, okay, y'all just coexist well together. Mm-mm. There is a separation that occurs when we walk pleasing the Lord. If you'd rather hear a different message, I'm sure there's other churches you could probably find that would tell you what you want to hear. I'd rather just live in the truth. Amen. Amen. And I know you would too. My point is this. I've wasted a lot of time in my life, and so have you, trying to somehow make the bondage of my life. And, you know, all bondage isn't about these big sins that we, you know, it's easy to pick those out. Many of us are in bondage. And in case you hadn't noticed, over the past several weeks, I've been talking to you about how to get strong on the inner man. That's what this is all about. I didn't put it out on the marquee, and I didn't announce a series. But where I've been is this. Several weeks ago, the Lord really burdened me with our need to become emotionally strong, with our need to become strong on the inner man. You see, we can't do what God's called us to do and be who God's called us to be as long as we continue to yield to the weakness. So if we keep playing to our weakness, guess what? We are weak. The time has come for us to become strong, to stand up in the face of whatever these things are that come against all of us for the purpose of destruction. There is a plan. There's a plan. Know that. There's a plan to kill you, to steal from you, to destroy you. That is the devil's plan. John 10:10, scriptural. But God has a plan. And light always overcomes darkness. Hallelujah. Maybe I love the light because I lived so long in the darkness that now I know the difference. But some of us find ourselves just kind of in the middle there. You know, it's kind of like gray's all right. I'm saying gray's not all right. And I don't know how many shades of gray there is, but none of it's all right. I've not read it, so don't anybody think I read it. And those of you who have read it, repent now. And then, no, that's okay. John 3:19. It says, and this is the condemnation, that the light has come into the world, but men love darkness rather than light, because their deeds were evil. Oh, well, now I'm beginning to understand even more. It's not, I can never be delivered from something I love. So, there is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus and do what? Who walk according to the Spirit and not after the flesh. But he said there is condemnation. You will feel condemnation because darkness condemns. Jesus convicts, but darkness condemns. And he said, this is the condemnation. You will find yourself feeling condemned because of the darkness. And when the darkness is there, first of all, it doesn't understand light. It never will. You can't make it play nice. Doesn't work that way. So the light has to overcome the darkness, has to rule over the darkness. So in darkness, there is obscurity and confusion. So when we find ourselves completely, that confusion swirling around us in our atmosphere, it's darkness. This is not light. So when I find myself, because darkness doesn't understand, then when darkness doesn't understand, I find myself in confusion, not sure what to do, feeling myself going down the hole. You know what I mean? You know, descending. And this confusion is around my life. It means that darkness is now ruling. So somewhere I have to stop and say, ooh, that's it. Wait a minute, no more. No more of that. But I can't love it. I can't love those things. I can't be delivered if I love it. If I'm still making room for it. If I'm still petting it. If I still feel I'm justified in it. Whatever that darkness may be. See, I know a lot of you, and God is good. He brings us together, and we're a bunch of people who, without God, none of us in here very good without Him. And I'm okay with that. I'm glad to say that I depend on Him entirely. And many of you understand what I'm talking about. A lot of us have come from very dark places and dark pasts and other things in our lives. You see, the favorite trick of the enemy is to make us believe that where we've come from, what we've experienced, how we've felt, all has a justified place of remaining in us because of what we've been through. Here's what I know. He separated the light from the darkness, and the light will overcome darkness. And I will not live in darkness, even though it has been such a part of me for so long. It is that darkness that the enemy plays to. So whatever that darkness is in your life, understand that's where the enemy's going to come. So he's going to deal with you in those areas, and you find yourself, and it's like this. You're looking at it saying it's so strong. I want you to think about the day that our God looked out on the earth in Genesis chapter 1, and it says the whole world, it was just a swirling mass of confusion, obscurity, darkness. It was a mess. Now, when he looked at that, he had to see that there was something in it that was worth separating out. In the same way, we have to look at our lives and the swirling masses of things that have occurred since we were children or whatever we've gone through, what our husbands did or didn't do, or our children or whatever it is. We have to look at that swirling mass of confusion and obscurity and all that darkness, and we have to believe that there's something worth extracting out of it. We got to separate the light out of the darkness. I've got to see that no matter how difficult it was and whatever I went through, that God was doing something in me that was worth saving and bringing to the light. I have to believe that no matter how difficult it has been and no matter what my journey has looked like, that in that swirling mess of what seemed to be all confusion and all the junk of life, that there was something precious in the midst of it, and I want to celebrate and separate the light from the darkness. Amen. What did you learn from it? Well, that's what I want to separate, so that now I live in light instead of living in the darkness. Y'all okay? Yeah. John 12:35. Then Jesus said to them, these are what Jesus is saying, a lot of this is a little while longer the light is with you. Walk while you have the light, lest darkness overtake you. He who walks in darkness does not know where he is going. So it becomes clear that we're being told it's essential that we stay in the light, that we keep walking in the light, because darkness can overtake you if you do not keep walking in the light. Clear. Isn't that clearly what he says? Ephesians 5:8, walk in the light, for you were once darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Walk as children of light. So he's beginning to say to us, okay, you are not stuck. You are not powerless. This darkness is not greater than the light of God in you. Now, I love that. Somebody should have said amen. 2 Corinthians chapter 6, it says, do not be unequally yoked together with unbelievers. For what fellowship has righteousness with lawlessness? And what communion has light with darkness? Okay, so now we're seeing that clearly, you know, you hear that about not being unequally yoked. What's he saying? He's saying this. We limit it to, you know, don't marry an unbeliever. It's much more than that. He's talking about who we are as believers. Don't unequally yoke yourself up with darkness. Don't keep messing around, playing around, justifying it with darkness, because there is no fellowship between light and darkness. Now, he sent us into the world. We're sent into the dark to bring light. Amen? So it's not that you separate, because there was an old thought, you know, you separate yourself, go, you know, build a commune and everybody live in it, and somehow you get in that commune and it's all light, and you know, it's not, because everybody has their own measure of darkness to bring into it. So it doesn't work that way. That's not what he's told us to do. In fact, he's told us we are the light, right? He talks about salt and light. He said, you know, you got to go out and salt. You got to go out in light. That's who we're supposed to be. We're not supposed to be hidden under a bushel. Our light's supposed to be shine. There should be a remarkable difference in who we are. We should arise and shine, for our light has come. But he's making it clear that if you continue to fellowship in darkness, that you are violating the very word of God, because there is no such thing. Light does not fellowship with darkness. I'm gonna help you here in just a minute. Romans 13:12. The night is far spent. The day is at hand. Therefore, let us cast off the works of darkness and let us put on the armor of light. Now, there are three meanings of this saying, and I want to spend just a moment here. It says, let us cast off the works of darkness. That phrase, cast off, means a few things. For one thing, it means take off your sleeping clothes. Take off whatever you were wearing to sleep in, whatever you wore in the dark, and dress for the light. Take off everything. I mean, think about this. When you've been, you know, sleeping all night, Jeff, you're going to get up and go fishing. You don't wear the same thing you wore in bed unless you are camping. But you're not going to go out in the hot sun. You're not going to get out there on the in your boat fishing without covering yourself, doing the things you do. You dress for the day. You dress for the purpose of the day. And so he's saying you got to cast it off. You got to lay off the things. Because when you were sleeping in your sin and in your bondage, you dressed a certain way. You do that in the night. But when the morning comes, you dress for the day. All of you this morning got up and you didn't have to even think twice about not wearing what you were wearing in bed before you came to church this morning. Well, I don't know. Maybe some of you. In the airports now, who knows? Everybody's in their pajamas, but that's all right. But you understand, the point is this, cast it off. In other words, you need to get rid of what you wore in the darkness. Don't look that way. Don't act that way. That's when you were asleep. Don't look like you're asleep. Don't look like you're in bed. You know, don't look like it's the night. You got to dress for the day, for the purpose. So you got to know what your purpose is. And now you begin to take on what is necessary for that day. Like, I have to take on the joy of the Lord. If I don't put on the joy of the Lord, I am prey to the enemy's discouragement. See, so I have to dress. I can't live. I can't operate in the sleeping clothes that I wore. I've got to come out of that, and I've got to dress for the purpose of the day. It also means this. It means not only that you get rid of the sleeping clothes, but it also has this connotation that you will, well, in their day, and in the Greek, in Greek history and culture, they would have games. They would have the, you know, where they would run and that sort of thing. Well, they would run naked. I don't know if you knew that or not. The original Olympics were all nude. Interesting thought. Anyway. Come to the light. Okay. So, the original games, they would come dressed to the race, but they would lay aside anything that they had on that would slow them down because they wanted to win the race. And it has that meaning, is that we've got to cast off anything that's going to slow us down in this race. Aren't you tired of it? I mean, I want to run. I wish I could run. Never been a runner in the natural. In this walk in God, let me put it this way, in this race that we are in, because we're in a race. It's been likened to that. Our walk is likened to the race, our life in Christ. In this race, everything that would slow us down, we have got to cast off. That's what it means. This is how we get rid of darkness. This is how light rules over darkness. We have to get rid of whatever it is that will slow us down. And you know what always kind of stops you, gets you
What is it? What's that thing that kind of hooks you every time? Got to cast that thing off. Now, the third thing that this word cast aside or cast off means it comes, it's a military term. And it has this meaning that when in Rome, when the Roman soldiers would be coming back from a campaign of some sort, and they would have been fighting and coming into the camp, and they're kind of just getting into the camp, and they go to bed. And for them, it was like they would go to bed with whatever they had on. They'd drop in the field. They were tired. The darkness came. People went to sleep. They didn't have showers and all that kind of stuff. They just kind of dropped wherever they were because that's the way it was. They couldn't do anything else. But as the sun was rising, there would be someone in the camp who would wake them up either by a trumpet or however they would do it to let the camp know. And they would make this declaration. They would say, "The night is departing. The day is advancing. Arise, comrades, and prepare to meet the light." We have to understand that we've got to put off everything, because here's what's going to happen. As soon as as day was approaching, light was coming, those soldiers had to get hold of their armor, whatever it was, shine it up from whatever the battle had been, because there was going to be an inspection at dawn. So they may have dropped in the battle, they may have been dirty and worn or whatever it is, but because when the sun came up and light would come, there would be an inspection by their officers who would come by and check them out. They would hear this, they would get up, they would do whatever they needed to do, get the dust off of the day before, and got ready to meet the light. We've got to cast off all those things. And even if we've dropped in the battle, even if we found ourselves where it felt like we could, weeping may last for a night, but joy comes in the morning. Amen. There is a morning for every one of us. There's a dawn that's coming in every situation in our lives. We've got to get ourselves ready to meet the day. I wish life were easier for everybody. I do. If I could do it for you, I would. God knows I've tried. I can't make it any better for myself. I sure can't make it better for you. What I can tell you is this, that we have to make a decision at some point in our lives how we're going to live. And that means we have to deny some things in us that we would call of the dark. I can't go play back in the playgrounds of my fears and insecurities and abuse and whatever yours is that you would name it. I can't do that. I'm not being unkind or unmerciful. In fact, what I'm saying to you is the most merciful thing I can say. Get up, get out, come out, arise and shine. Get up out of the dust. Come on, shake yourself free now. Come on, you can do this thing. And no matter what you've been told or what it feels like on the inside of you, like, I don't know how to get out of this, I'm telling you, shake yourself free. Get in the presence of God. Meet the day, meet the light, and say, I might have failed 50 times yesterday, but today I'll try to not fail but 49. Amen? We can't measure each other's process. But I can tell you one thing. Our job on this earth, one of them, is to run with each other. And when one stumbles, to help them stand and keep running. See, I'm not going to judge you in the stumble. But I'm going to grab hold of you. I'm going to say, come on. Come to the light. Amen. Don't you want to be that person for somebody? See, if you're always the one that's stuck in your own darkness, it's difficult to be that. Colossians 1:13 says, He has delivered us from the power of darkness and conveyed us into the kingdom of the Son of His love.
1 Peter 2, but you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, and a holy nation, his own special people, that you may proclaim the praises of him who called you out of darkness and into his marvelous light, who once were not a people, but are now the people of God, who had not obtained mercy, but now have obtained mercy. Arise, shine, for thy light has come, and the glory of the Lord has risen upon you. For behold, darkness will cover the earth, and deep darkness the people. But the Lord will rise upon you, and his glory will appear upon you. I want you to understand this morning, darkness comes in everyone's lives, and we all deal with darkness in one way or another. But we have been called as a special and chosen people. We do not stand as those who are helpless and without power. We are those who have been empowered by the very Spirit of God. We have been called and made into a people. God's been fashioning us to become his royal priesthood. He's called us to be something in this earth. The world is full of darkness. We have to arise and shine because gross darkness covers the people. But there must be a remarkable difference. You don't light a lamp and put it under a bushel. That's what Jesus said. You don't do that. Instead, you put it up where it can be seen. We're supposed to be seen. There should be a remarkable difference. And let me tell you something. Guilt, shame, and condemnation are the enemy's most favorite attempts to and tools that he uses to keep us from being the light. I don't care if you mess up. Just go ahead, even if you mess up, and the next second say glory to God. You understand that? People say, well, you're not being a good testimony. Look, not being a good testimony is going into darkness and obscurity where you don't make a difference. Nobody's perfect, and you don't get it right all the time, but you keep going in the light. You keep fellowshipping in the light. You'll be shocked how it will overcome the darkness in your life. Everybody's waiting to get qualified. Well, when this happens and that happens, when I'm better at this or when, you know, that changes in my... Just stop it. Just come on into the light. Stop making excuses for how hard it is. I know how hard it is. I get it. But everywhere you go and everything you do, there ought to be something different about you. What good is salt if it's lost its savor? It's what he's saying. You may not have it all right, but you're salty. Try not to cuss and then witness, but if you do, still say praise the Lord. You understand what I'm saying? Oh, God knows. I can't believe I just said that. Just remember that coming out of your mouth, you can defile or you can bless. So it's who cares about cussing? What matters is that what's coming out of your mouth is not defiling. You get that? Because some people can cuss without ever saying a cuss word. Some people can cut you to the floor. Right? Do we defile? That's what matters. You understand what I'm saying? The way we talk, the way we think, the way we live, the people we hang around, and all of that is what has to be brought to the light. I know you'd like to be able to say, well, this part is God's and this part is... That's not the way it is. We've been translated, transferred. You've gotten a transfer out of darkness. You don't belong there anymore. You're no longer a member. You don't have citizenship anymore in darkness. I mean, you have lost your homeland. You have to come out of darkness. See, when we are translated into the Son of His love, that means we have come into the kingdom of life. That is to go back there is just, you have to work at it. Because we've been called to the light. And everything was brought to the light. Not just a little bit. You didn't just get barely saved. You didn't just get, you know, half of me got saved. All of you, 100%. Everything. So what I've reserved over here in darkness is against everything that Jesus died for. It's the truth. It's trampling the spirit of grace. You okay? I don't want to do that. I'm not perfect. You're not either. But I don't want to do that. So I need him to deal with me in the light and show me the truth. And I have to love truth so that as he shows me the truth, he can change me. And what was darkness can now come in submission to the light of God in my life. Amen. Stand to your feet. I know that a lot of the things I've been teaching over the last few weeks are easier said than done. I already know that. I know that it's easier in the presence of God and in the moment when we're all together saying amen to, you know, grab hold of it. But here's what I found out in this walk with God. I found out that it's progressive as we grow in God, as long as we don't stop. As long as we don't let something keep us where we are. I love it that his mercies are new every morning. You know why they are? Because we wouldn't, he'd have to kill us all if they weren't. It's the truth. But that's the God that we serve, who every day wipes the slate clean. His mercies are new every morning. And when I say that, I don't mean that, you know, you can just keep sinning every day and just know it gets absolved somehow. But what I am saying is that every day of our lives can be a fresh start. And sometimes we get discouraged because we've tried and we haven't seemed to be able to get free. Darkness seems to overtake us easily. Well, you know what? You're one day closer, one step closer. But sometimes we hide those things. Now, I don't want to be your, you know, priest confessor. I'm not looking to hear about all your darkness. But I am going to say this. Everybody needs somebody where they can talk through the process in their lives. When you start trying to do that by yourself, you're not a good one to help yourself. If you coulda, you woulda, and you didn't. Right? You know, I'm glad that I have people in my life. When I feel that the darkness is kind of overtaking. I'm glad. And that's what we all need. That is not a weakness. That's where you find strength. Amen. So, prayer together. And let me say this. It needs to be somebody who's going to get you out of darkness, not somebody who's going to play with it. Let's just get real. Let's be real. Let's live this life full of the joy of what it means to have been delivered from every plan of the enemy and from darkness and to live in the light of God. To be light in this earth. To be used by God in our everyday lives. What's better than that? You know, you can do all kinds of missionary endeavors. And the truth is, there's enough people sitting here in this room that could turn Lakeland upside down. If we would be the light and live in the light. Father, I stand before you today with a genuine heart's desire to bring light, to be light, to let your light shine before men through me. Today I want to shake myself free from everything that has held me in bondage. Lord, I'm ready. I'm ready. I'm tired of slowing down in this race. If that's you, and you, as I'm praying, I just want you to lift your hand. Just wave it before the Lord. You're not showing me anything. I don't even have my eyes open. I just want you to make your commitment before the Lord. And just say, I want to run this race. I'm tired of being held back in this race. I want to meet the day. I'm ready to meet the light. Preparing myself, putting on the armor of light. Hallelujah. Being ready, Lord, to be used in any way you want to use me. I won't go back. Can't go back
to the way it used to be
before your presence came and changed me. Can anybody remember? Can anybody remember? I won't go back there.
Can't go back
to the way it used to be before your presence came
and changed me.
I want to live in the light of your love, Lord. I won't go back, can't go back to the way it used to be before your presence came and changed me. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Before your presence came
and changed.
Hallelujah. Today we pray for you and believe for you that you'll walk in the joy of the Lord. You will know his strength. You will find the light of God that's in you and shake yourself free so that his light can show forth through what has been darkness in our lives. Are y'all in it with me? Are you in it to win it with me? That's where we're going. Amen. We're going to move on. Become like Jesus every step of the way. And sometimes it's only one step. And sometimes it's a baby step. Doesn't matter. We're still going to make progress. Amen. God bless you. Thank you for being here this week. We just appreciate you so much. But understand this, that God changes the world one person at a time through one person at a time. So the same God who's changed you has empowered you to help change the lives of others. So as you go forth this week, remember that you are light and salt. You have to be perfect. Just have to be present in the light. Amen. God bless you as you go. Hallelujah.